I want to give the church, you guys, the opportunity. Is there someone that wants to say something to Tony? We have a mic that's going to be floating around. You can just raise your hand and we'll get to you. Or you may have a question. You know, this is now the opportunity for you to speak to our brother, you know. So, this is...
I have a very close bond with this, with the Alonzo family. And we've gone on many vacations together, and I worked with Cheryl for many years with the children. And it's amazing to see her faith. There are many things that struck me, and sometimes you wonder, why God, why this person? And then you also realize that God is also, he's in a struggle. It's a universal, it's a cosmic struggle. And a lot of times the devil is he's accusing God of being unfair and of being, you know, just bad. And sometimes God needs people to prove him wrong, just as he used Job, just as he used Jobed. And it's not easy for God to watch his children suffer. But if nobody stands up for him, it makes it a lot harder for him to say, for to him to seem like a loving God. And he chose Cheryl, in my mind, because he knew that she would be faithful to him to the end. And she was. He knew that she had a way with words, and he allowed her to write a blog and to express so many things in that blog that have been able to help so many people. And we don't know why God does the things he does. All we can do is to know that he has a reason why he's doing it. And one day, we will see her again. One day, we'll be able to ask God ourselves. We won't have to ask anybody else. And he's going to be willing to explain and to let us know why he did the things that he did. But in all of this, I've known Tony, but I got a different respect for Tony. And it made me really understand the value of for better or for worse. Because Tony was there in the better, and he was definitely there in the worst of it. And the way that he took care of his wife was amazing. He put everything aside so that he could spend time with his wife and his family. And that was, to me, a sermon to show not only the love of a husband to the wife, but it also was a symbol of the love of God that God has for us, that he is able to sacrifice even the little things that we take for granted, just to put a smile on his wife's face. He was able to change his whole income, employment, everything, just to be able to be there for her and to comfort her. And through the years, it's just made me just realize, you know, us strength that we didn't know we had or we didn't have before. And that's a promise that he gives, that if we would just let go and let him take care, that he'll do that. But it's hard to let go. It's easier to ask, why me? Than to say, why not me? It's easier to try and to rationalize it and to say, well, so-and-so is doing this and they seem to be fine. I'm here trying to do another thing and Lord, why me? But as I said before, God needs people that he can put before the universe and say, just as he did with Job, have you considered my servant Job? Have you considered my servant Cheryl? Have you considered my servant Sherianne? And I almost wonder, can God brag about me? Is he going to be able to say, can you consider my servant me down? Or is he going to have to make excuses for me? Is he going to say, well, you know, he's just having a bad day, give him time. But we should always strive to get to that point where no matter what, God is able to turn around and brag about us, just as he's bragging about Cheryl, just as he's bragging about Sherianne. And it's not easy. I know Tony's a quiet person. For him to make this video and to open up, it's not easy. But that's the whole reason we're here, is to support each other in times like these. And to learn that whatever we're going through, that doesn't have to define us, as long as we keep our focus on God.
I do have a question. Good afternoon, church. What is it that you have learned from God throughout this experience, something that you didn't know before? And how would you help other people that are going through this situation, like with family members that have cancer or any sickness?
Good question. I think the most important thing I've learned, I mentioned in the video, which is God is in everybody. Like I said, I searched for God. I stayed up nights asking him, waiting to hear his voice. But his voice came in the folks that visited, in the folks that provided, and the folks that prayed. So I learned that sometimes you look for God in your head, and really he's in all of us, around us. Help, I would say, you know, you've got to cling close to God, and sometimes what you think is what his plan is, it's not. And so you have to be ready for anything. And if you're prepared, and if you walk with him daily, you will be ready for anything.
Good. Good question. Anyone else? Yes.
Hi, Tony. My name is Phil. I wanted to ask, how did it strengthen your will and your faith? And just how did you listen to the Holy Spirit and how did he guide your faith?
Good question. I think a lot of times God's going to tear you down to nothing. He's going to take away everything. So in the end, you have nothing else to cling to but him. No one's going to give you the satisfaction. No one's going to give you what you're looking for, because they themselves are struggling. So you really have no other choice but to look to him. And once you do, it brings a peace over you. And you don't even know how it happens, and you don't even know how you get by every day, but you just do. And I wouldn't say it gets any easier, but you learn to look at things a different way and appreciate even the pain at times, which sounds a little harsh, but it's the reality.
I just want to thank you for your courage in sharing, because I've grown up listening to sermons that always assured the listeners that God will move your mountains, and now I'm realizing that there are times when the mountain is supposed to remain. And the way with which you have navigated the storm with grace is inspiring me, because my mountain is still present. It's not being removed, as all of those very optimistic sermons have predicted. So I would like to thank you and to share with you my favorite verse. They who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings, on wings as eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. Thank you for the grace with which you have navigated the storm. Thank you for sharing that there are times that our mountains aren't moved, but God is still present. He has not abandoned us when this happens. I needed this lesson a lot. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. With that, we're now going to hear Sherry Ann's story, so we can play the video.
I'm in tears. I'm really, really moved. This is my first time at this church with my neighbor, my son. I know how hard it is to be a woman and wonder, can we have children? Can we be a good wife? You know, and there was one quote that I had to share with you that has helped me. My life has taken so many different turns, and I've been lost. I've asked so many times, why, if this is where I want to be, why has my path been so winding? But there's a reason, and one of my favorite quotes that I wanted to share with you was, it's not from the Bible, but it's helped me a lot. Until God opens the next door, praise Him in the hallway. Mm-hmm. So, although we're not maybe exactly where we want to be, it's okay. So, thank you for your story too.
Sherry Ann, when you said that you don't feel beautiful or undesirable, just remember Psalm 149, which says that you're fearfully and wonderfully made. You're a beautiful woman, inside and out, and the only organ that God looks at is your heart. You have a beautiful heart. Praise you.
I know we're not used to this, but I wanted to do this because it's very easy for us every week to come here and get dressed up, and we come here, sing the song, hear the sermon, and we leave. But we have real people that are hurting. And even though they're hurting, they have not walked away from God. You want a sermon? You want to see a sermon? Here it is right here. You're seeing three. And so, anyone else? Because I have a question for Stephanie. But I wanted to give the church. And I want to thank for the visitors. The first service we had it, and now this, where man, they just step up. They grab the mic and they just spoke, even though they're not. This is not their church. So thank you. Anyone else? All right, Stephanie, tell us, how are you prevailing in your faith?
Okay, this is the second time the pastor is asking me this question, because he asked me in the first. And I know I didn't do exactly what he wanted me to do. I'm hiding behind, you know, other things. But I have to be real. I have to be as transparent as Sherry Ann was in her testimony. First of all, I want to tell you that it's not an easy road to be a caregiver of someone that is very dear to you. Two, a lot of tears. I cry every day. That's for real. Sometimes it's not crying because I'm sad, but crying to see where God takes us sometimes and how he brings us through. And I'm referring to sometimes when I doubt him a lot. I ask why I can't pray. Someone calls and asks me about Sharia and I can't say anything. I break down. It hurts. I feel the pain that she feels. And sometimes even to pray with her, it takes so much out of me. But I do it. And I learned from this experience, the joy of the Lord has to be your strength. I had to delve in the Word a lot, go back to my promise boxes, pull every promise that God has made, believing that he's going to keep every promise that he has made, because God does not lie. And so I had to learn something else, how to pray. When we are praying for something like this, we can't pray and then take back the problem and worry about it. So sometimes while I am praying earnestly and I had a good week and I come there at the front and I am reading with smiles on my face but a heavy heart inside, burdened, and then I ask for people, please remember my niece and pray. I mean it when I ask that. And I want everybody to know that when someone tells you that, take some time to say, what specifically do you want me to pray about? Don't just leave it like that and then forget about it. And then when I tell you again next time, pray for my niece. Oh, she's sick? So I know very well that you didn't pray for her. You know, so don't play those games with God, because when I am asking for prayer, we are praying to a mighty God. I have a prayer partner who is in Trinidad and she calls me every day. And when we pray the prayer of faith, going to the throne boldly. So when we ask the Lord for healing, we get up from our knees believing that God has healed. So I don't feel happy when I, after praying like that, and I meet someone, and they're asking me, so what are you doing about it? How? I said, I'm praying about it. You know, but they still don't understand. So well, how does the family feel about it? I said, we are all prayer warriors, and we can't be praying and taking back the problem and not believing that God will answer our prayer. It may not be how we want it, but so far I can tell you that God has been answering our prayer. Sherry looks this way, but her CAT scan doesn't look the way she's looking here now. So doctors are confused. So I always grasp the opportunity in this process to witness to them, because here in Miami, the doctors have done absolutely nothing additional to what Sherry Ann got in Cuba. The doctors in Cuba did everything that can be done surgically to the mass. She still remains with two huge masses inside. The last appointment we had on Monday, the doctors are questioning her, so do you have shortness of breath? She says, no. Do you have pain? No. No question they asked. She said, yes. And the doctor had to say, I'm encouraged by the lab results that you have, because one of the markers went down by 50%, which is unheard of. It's only God. So when he said that, I had to tell him that you're encouraged by that, but I'm encouraged by the fact that God is answering our prayer. Amen. And so in this experience, I've learned through it all, as the song says, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. And I've learned to depend upon his word.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Stephanie.
I'm a nurse. I work in the ICU. And I know a lot of times when we pray, it's very difficult for us because most of our prayers, we want the answer to be yes. And sometimes it is no, and it's very difficult for us to deal with. For me, myself, what I try to encourage myself with is Isaiah 26:3, which says that, you know, when we pray to Him, He will keep our mind. If we keep our mind on Him, He will give us peace. And that's the best verse, I think, that I can give to you all up there. And that's Isaiah 26:3.
Thank you.
I think as that will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is on thee.
Wow, I think you have all of us very emotional. I see you every Sabbath with a big smile, welcoming everybody into church. And the last thing that I would have ever imagined is that you're going through such a painful experience. I think God is also trying to show us that we as the body of Christ shouldn't just be doing what's expected to say is always, yeah, I'm good, everything's good. It's a song that says, but if we are the body, why aren't my hands moving? You know, and it really hurts me because I'm part of the body that's not moving. I thank you for sharing, you know, because it awakens our conscience that we should be moving. And I pray to God that He gives us all the strength to wake up and start moving, you know.
Hello, good afternoon, church.
Good afternoon.
I'm a visitor here, but your story definitely touched my life. You know, I'm a chaplain, actually, at Jackson Memorial, the main campus, not South. But of course, I'm sorry for whatever experience that you did go through over there. But I'd like to speak to not only Tony, right, but the church. One of my experiences is that I realized that not a lot of church people, not a lot of Christians that I deal with, they know what to do, right? Like, so they're always, in my experience personally, I feel like the people who don't believe in God in the hospital that I will talk to have a easier way, in a way, and it sounds weird, have an easier way of going through these things that they just, okay, well, it happened, let's move on, we don't really have any other hope. And I've always wondered, I'm like, do we as a community, do we talk about these things? Do we talk about that? As the song said, if the mountain is not moved, what then? You know, and I just want to commend the church to keep talking about these things, to equip your members to what to do with that, what to do with that grief, what to do with that pain, and to just open the floor up for your members to be well equipped. And of course, Tony, you know, you're very brave in doing this, and I like to commend you. I know I don't know you guys from anywhere, but I just, you know, want to just say thank you for this experience.
They say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Well, good thing, a little faith is all I have right now. But God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be able to sing. It is well with my soul. I know you're able, and I know you can sink through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is word.